2007.
Got some Dilla collection. Shout to her for hooking it up.
Like my whole
Avilia.
Avila.
Avila. I do Avilia.
Build up your shirt.
Thank you, my
dude. Yeah, bro. I'm a Rio.
You guys ready to play your shit? Some of you guys are nervous. I can see it in your eyes. Let's get this going. Are we ready? Josh, are you ready? This is my man, Jay Jules. He does all my video stuff. He's also a great producer. I might put you on the spot tonight to play something. You already know I was gonna pick it. But then making the shit and then playing, DJing by playing your own shit.
It's like better than sex.
Well, it could be debatable.
And got Ableton.
Yeah. Nice. Yep. And now you're just hitting one button.
I don't know what that means.
You'll get it. You're only a couple months in. I chunk. I like that. What about you?
Great white shark.
Great white shark?
Yeah.
What about chunky white shark?
Yeah.
Just an idea, throwing it out there. If you guys started a collective, like on some fun shit, create a new name and a brand new SoundCloud account and just start like putting this stuff out. Create like some videos to go with the music. Obviously post on Instagram. Like start with Instagram, YouTube, SoundCloud.
I've just been scared to drop and stuff, but I have so much music.
It's there's no use of it sitting on your hard drive. You guys just put music out, man. Like you guys, you can really build this up to something. Put a little Chunky Tuna. That's cool. Guys, Chunky Tuna. I'm watching you guys. I'm following you guys.
Working with singers and stuff.
Totally. So I can go over it like the basic. Let's say you produce a song for, who's your favorite artist?
Chris Martin from Coldplay.
Okay. I didn't expect that, but yeah. All right, so Chris Martin from Coldplay. And let's throw a rapper on there, like just.
Kanye,
okay. And it's a beat that you produced and you produced it by yourself. So no musicians, no collaborators, no co-producers, no samples, just you. We'll assume that Chris Martin wrote and performed the hook and Kanye wrote and performed his own raps. So when you make a song, you have to look at it like a 100% pie. So by default, this pie is split into two parts. One half is the writing portion. And the other half is the publishing portion. The portion that you really want to focus on is the writing portion. Basically, whatever ends up happening in the writing portion is a mirror image of what happens on the publishing portion. The writing portion is also split into two, all right? So the first half of the writing portion is the writer-performer, the vocalist who performed on the track, all of the songwriters on the track. So anything that has to do with lyrics, voice, that all falls under writer performer, okay, which is half of the writing portion. Because you're the producer, you didn't write anything on it, so you don't get any of that. Chris Martin's lawyer and Kanye's lawyer agreed to just split everything down the middle, which probably wouldn't happen in that scenario, but let's just assume Kanye would get a piece and Chris Martin would get a piece, and they're gonna split it in half. So that means that Kanye gets 50% of the writer performer and Chris Martin gets 50% of the writer performer. Now that's 25%. So what they're really walking away with is 12.5. So now let's look at the writer composer side. So the composer side is the music, the producer, the instruments, the melodies. Since you're the only producer, you get 100%. So which is 100%, which is 25. You get the whole piece. So now when we look at the publishing side, Kanye gets what? 12.5. Chris Martin 12.5 with publishing. And then you get 25%. 12.5 is 25%. So Chris Martin walks away with 25%, and Kanye walks away with 25%. So 25, 25, 50.
I got all the artists. I got enough music for the whole year. Here's some funding.
Mm-hmm.
Go crazy with the
secure funding. So what do you mean? Like for what?
I just need a budget for every release. We want to do it right, like an independent record label.
Got it.
But we don't want to sign no artists, we want to partner with them.
You'd be surprised. There's a lot of things you can do for very cheap. There was this video from yesterday. Producer played a video. Actually, it was an artist, and it was a lyric video, like a full lyric video. And it looked amazing, like fully animated, the whole shit. I was like, yo, who did the video? And he was like, some guy on Fiverr. Yeah, you know?
But we'll know which records deserve the most push.
You kind of don't, because really where it's at now is like the people determine the hit record.
Right.
You know, so like we can hear a record and feel like it's a smash, right? One like way that you can really test records that's like really helpful is SoundCloud.
Right.
So like if you wanted to do this, you can take like some of these records, don't release them on streaming platforms yet, right. Just release them on SoundCloud only, and then like do like a little soft push. And then let's say you release 10 records on SoundCloud over the next 10 days or 15 days. You do that and then you figure out which one is getting the most traffic. And then you can be like, ooh, this is the one that people like. So then you pull it private and then you put a campaign behind that song. You know, I'm always gonna be a fan of the singles thing, because it's almost like you're giving people enough chances to decide to become a fan. If you drop an album, you know, and the statistics show, most of the plays happen on track number one. Mm-hmm. So they'll listen to the intro, yeah. And then so let's say you drop an album, track one gets 5,000 streams on whatever platform. Track number two, you have 2,500 streams. Track number three is down to 800, and then by the time you get to the bottom, there's like five plays. They lose interest, right? Especially if it's a new artist. It just, dropping an album makes no sense unless you want people to just hear your intro. So you might as well just put a single out. Single, single, single. And then after you drop 50, one of them goes viral, hopefully, or it gets enough plays, and then you can work from there.
And this was produced by Lyric.
What do you know?
Also the vocals, the whole song was mixed by Phil.
Yeah, and you're writing everything?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Writing. Do you feel like you have a shortage of beats, or do you have like a good amount of beats to work with like consistently?
I like to create beats off of energy with like people, mm-hmm. But I think there's a nice exchange.
Doing it in person.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're doing everything you should. Like you're really in tune with your artistry, like you know what you want, you know what you want to do. You have some producers you're working with already, you have a recording set up, you're in New York.
I wanted to ask you about, like, because my sound is like really street jazz, but is that even like a thing?
There's so many artists in your position that are trying to create a new thing, but they can't, you know? And I think you have something unique and special. It's really, really cool.
There is a market for, especially recently with the rise of like people like her,
mm-hmm.
Ari Lennox, I mean, like, I mm-hmm. those vibes.
Go outside of your comfort zone a little bit too. Just try different things, do some interesting, unexpected stuff. Yeah. I feel like that's where like greatness is really, where you can find greatness is when you go outside of something you normally do, and then you stumble on something that's like super innovative.
Something like that.
Yeah, bro. Yeah.